Welcome to my channel. My name is Caleb, and this is the Andrew Tate interview. Now, before we begin, it should go without saying that I am not a misogynist, I am not a homophobe, I am a bit of a gluttonist. Anything that falls under those categories that is stated by Andrew Tate, I do not agree with. I feel like that should go without saying. Andrew Tate interview, more like Andrew Late interview. Got my sparkling water, got my cigar, can't be Alfred. All right. Also got sunglasses because I predict he'll be wearing sunglasses. We'll see, though. I would consider myself a man of strong morals and ethics. I have a diverse friend group. In fact, my editor is a woman. Tara, am I a misogynist? Be honest. I think Tara is more of a misogynist than I am. To be honest. What's up, G? Look at my my profile picture, too. He waved to me. He f***ing did the Discord sticker wave. This dude's got kittens everywhere, I bet. I believe it is important to have conversations with people that are heavily disagreed with to find out why. And to be honest, I think we found out a few reasons why in today's interview. It was very entertaining.
Nice sunglasses and cigar.
How you doing, man? I got f***ing, you got sparkling water or what?
Who do you think I am? Of course I do.
Of course, bro. But yeah, if you don't agree, that's totally fine. I respect that. Feel free to move on. Press the dislike button. Cancel me. Whatever you want to do. I'm here to entertain above all else. You've been blowing up, right? It's like, that's undoubtable. I did want to ask Andrew an important question, and that is, does he think that he's ruining a generation of kids? I asked it in kind of a roundabout way. That's what I've been seeing the most of, right? He seems to agree that his advice really is not for children. There's plenty of sources of advice out there that will not compel you into a life of a GTA, NPC, mafia boss, misogynist guy, right? There's a lot of advice out there. There's a lot of allegations. And let's just go ahead and get into those. I asked him about all of them. Because how can someone be called so much shit and do so many things wrong and still be around? I have no f***ing idea.
I would agree with that. I've been blowing up. Like, even the Matrix is sending its enemies to try and prevent my conquest. Even now, the reason there was a slight delay is because inside of my podcast studio, and it was ridiculously loud, making that cricket noise.
Yeah,
thought, I can't do a podcast with a cricket noise.
Yeah, of course not.
All of my women are asleep. So I had to find it myself. So I've got it here just for the world to know and for all future crickets.
Right.
You get any ideas? I don't know if the camera could see it. I will find you. Mm-hmm. And you will die.
Yeah, I know exactly. There's plenty of crickets. I'm in Texas, by the way, in the United States. I've got a cricket gun specifically for crickets and scorpions as well. This shoots it's a small bullet with a plastic cap on the end, and it has a bunch of small, tiny BBs in it, like salt. You shoot them and it blows them up.
I need to buy one of them. I just did it typical London style, because I grew up in London, so you just get a big knife.
Okay.
That's how we do things over in England.
Stabbing. For basically acid?
Yeah. Any problem you have, right. It's either acid or knife.
Okay, that's true.
But I'm making this declaration public to when the Matrix wants to send its cricket agents or any crickets that think they're gonna get away with it. I don't care how long it takes, I will find you and I will stab you.
Okay, that's fair. That's a fair proclamation, Cobra Tate.
As long as they know. Now that everyone knows, now when they turn up, it's fair game because they knew what was gonna happen to them.
Okay. So I have a question for you. So I saw you tweet today. By the way, your name is Morpheus on Twitter. That's an interesting choice of a name.
That's not me, bro. I don't know who that is. That must be someone pretending to be me. That's definitely not me. I'm not allowed a Twitter account, so I definitely
Right. Yeah, you've been banned. So some alter ego of some kind.
Something weird.
Pretending to be you. Yeah, it's not. It's just, maybe just Morpheus. Maybe it is him.
It might be the real Morpheus. Yeah, I think it might be.
So you tweeted, or sorry, Morpheus tweeted about morality. I thought that was fascinating. I think about morality a lot myself, not in any sort of higher intelligence way. I just think about the word because it sounds fun to say. So I have a question for you, right? There's a trolley coming down the tracks, and ahead there are five people tied to the tracks and are unable to move. This is it's a morality question. You've seen these before. You've probably heard of these. The trolley will continue coming and will kill the five people. There's nothing you can do to rescue the five people except there is a lever. If you pull the lever, the train will be directed to another track, which has one person tied to it. You have two choices. Do nothing, and the five people will die, or pull the lever and you will kill a single man. What would you do?
I've obviously heard this question before.
Of course. It's very common.
I found it particularly puzzling. And the reason why is because I think whoever wrote the question, as smart as they thought they were, I don't really feel tied to the situation. Like, they would have to compel me to feel responsible.
Okay.
So in said scenario, I guess my answer would be do nothing and let five people die. But not because I chose that it's better to let five die than right. the one guy. It's just more like, there's five dudes tied up. I didn't tie them up. There's right. a train coming. I ain't driving that train. I'm just being me. I'm hunting crickets. I'm smoking cigars. I'm walking down the street.
Yeah.
Doing my thing. Being rich.
Right.
Now there's this scenario over there. Hey, look, those people are tied up. Look, a train's coming. I'm very much like, it ain't much to do with me. Like,
okay.
That's not my problem. Like,
Right.
Issue. Hey, but Andrew, there's a lever. If you press the lever, who the fuck are you? Don't come talk to me about levers. I don't know you. I'm on my way somewhere. I got stuff to do. I don't think I'd run over there like Superman, get involved, analyze the scenario,
right.
understand the levers. Like, it just feels okay. Like, I don't.
It's a waste of time. It's not making you money. Who the fuck cares?
I simply am not there.
Like, how the fuck did these five get tied up anyway? There's five of you.
Fight back. Yeah, I see where you're coming from. Okay.
You need to, for a morality question, for me to answer it and truthfully have to, you're going to have to give me a scenario in which I am compelled to do something. I need to be compelled to act. Like, I need to be involved. Right. That has to be my fault.
Okay.
None of that's my fault. So it's not my problem.
I have some hot takes that you have here. And also, I have a lot of questions too that some of them you might not want to answer, to be honest with you. Men can only cheat if they are in love. Women cheat just by talking to a man because they're emotionally invested. Do you still believe that men can only cheat if they are in love?
Yes, I absolutely not really believe that. I think a man having sex with another woman who he doesn't care about is not cheating. A woman cannot have sex with a man she doesn't care about. If she can, she's a fundamentally broken woman, and she's not the kind of woman you want to associate with anyway. When a woman cheats, it's an emotional decision.
If a man cheats, it's a purely physical decision. I think that when we talk about cheating, you're talking about love, you're talking about relationships, you're talking about the infidelity inside of the relationship.
And if a relationship is based on emotion, then emotion must be involved in the infidelity. If I am in love with a woman completely and I sleep with someone else who I don't care about, that is not cheating, that is exercise.
Okay. Walk is like using an elliptical versus doing a bench press. You see it that way.
Women have a bunch of toys, right? They use toys. Is that cheating?
No.
It's purely pleasure without emotion, correct?
Yes, that is correct.
Okay, well, that's what I call hoes. So.
Yeah, I understand the logic. Yes, I get your logic. That does track in my mind. I understand that.
Good. And then there's going to be women who come along and try and counter it and say, well, I can sleep with men without caring about them. And they think that somehow makes me look stupid.
Yeah.
They think that somehow they get to prove that my point is wrong, but they don't realize when they say that, all they're doing is showing the world that they are actually trash. Because any woman of any kind of merit, any woman with a good heart and a spirit which is intact cannot be sleeping with men she doesn't give a solitary fuck about. So when I argue with these feminists and they sit here and go, well, I can sleep with men and not care about them. Ha, I win. I proved my point. Really, what they're doing is showing the world that they are. And they don't prove anything. Any woman with a good heart is not people she does not like. Whereas there are men out here, every man watching this knows, has been sitting on a date, listening to some chick talk, literally thinking in his mind, I don't like you as a person. Everything you're saying offends me. You're a nasty, entitled, horrible individual. I'm going to fuck you anyway. Men can do that. You are false.
Yeah. I mean, I haven't been on a lot of dates in my life, to be fair. I'm on the grind set. I'm a Sigma male. Okay. I'm one step from being a virgin. All right. Like, I'm just going to be honest with you. I haven't reached I own businesses too. I run businesses. I feel like there's a lot of things we have in common. You know, I have more hair.
I could teach you the magic, but the point is that a man will sit there and a woman will be genuinely offending to him, but purely because she's attractive, he'll do it anyway. Whereas a woman, if you genuinely offend her, she won't sleep with you. So,
okay,
the whole paradigm is different. And I stand by what I said. I meant every word I've ever said. In fact, let me make this a public statement. I hope this ends up on TikTok. I mean everything I've ever said. Everything I have ever said, I absolutely entirely meant. It was not for effect. It was not exaggerated. And at the time I said it, I meant it absolutely. Now, I'm not saying I can't change my mind in case anyone out they're smart and they might find conflicting opinions. At the time I state said opinion, I believe said opinion absolutely and utterly. And I am not going to be sorry for changing my mind or changing an opinion. At the time, that's what I believe. I say what I believe. I've never lied to anybody. So if you will listen to me say something and you go, he doesn't mean that, it's got to be exaggerated, I'm sorry to break it to you. I meant it. All of it. Head to toe, every single fucking word.
There's a few questions in here that are going to really add some weight to what you just said, by the way. They're a little goofy. Just for, I'm doing the more serious stuff, more professional stuff. I have some things that I would consider interesting to me personally because I am a... I have autism, just to be honest with you. But yeah,
okay,
so...
Stop.
Yeah, okay. I have Asperger's.
You have Asperger's, yes. Which is a form of autism, correct?
Right, yes.
But autism is a very, very large scale.
It's a broad spectrum, yeah.
Because you have autists who are functioning, and you have autists who literally can't even function in society, don't understand English, like, completely, right?
Yeah, I can't play the piano, but I can make it really uncomfortable.
Cool.
How would you find yourself, like, what would you say is a characteristic or a particular behavioral pattern you have which is different than a normal person, for example? What do you do that's not normal?
I would say people talking to me who I am in direct vicinity with on a consistent basis, my direct family members, say something to me and I do not care and I have zero empathy towards what they're saying, or if people, I don't know, like if people, like people don't come to me with their problems because I just don't, I don't know, I don't understand. You know, is that what you got?
Fuck either. I don't care. Oh, what happened, Mary? Oh, what? There was five people on a train track.
Oh no, fuck!
Don't care.
I care though. Yeah, I try to care. I mean, I like tried it because these people that are saying I have a problem, that they are expressing that as a negative thing, and I'm just like, I don't. There's nothing in my mind that makes me inherently care. So I don't know. Yeah, that's to answer your question. Yeah. Do you think that women are property? And that's something that a lot of people have asked me as well when I told them I was going to be talking to you. Like, he's a fucking sexist, bro. Why are you talking to him? You're just going to be fucking elevating, you know, putting him into the limelight. And I want to know. Like, I just want to know what you think of that. Obviously, what you think is going to be interesting. I'm looking forward to your response.
Sure. So I think my sister is her husband's property. Yes. When a bride is walking down the aisle to marry the groom, the father walks next to her and gives her away. True or false?
That is something that happens. Yes.
So you're giving her away, correct?
Yes.
Does that not sound at least in some way semi-related to property at some degree?
Some form of ownership. Yes.
Form of ownership. Does the Bible say the woman owns the husband owns the woman?
I believe it does.
Does the Quran say that the man owns the woman? Mm-hmm. Yes. So this is all ancient, right? All the things I'm saying are things that were largely accepted by society forever.
Yeah.
I'm not saying anything new. I'm not saying anything which is really, truly even controversial. The whole world agreed that the woman belongs to the man when she decides to give herself to a man. The whole world agreed that. Now, I'm not saying that a woman walking down the street by herself, a single woman, is some kind of property to whatever. I'm not saying that.
Yeah.
Society may have changed. These women may think they're not property yet.
I see exactly what you're saying. And I want to bring this up too. So a lot of the thing, like, you've been going viral on TikTok. I have a couple friends who do not like you at all. I'm going to be honest with you. They don't like you at all. Okay. Do you know who Leon Lush is? Do you remember him? I'm friends with Leon. He's a very good dude. I base all of my, the respect that I have for people based on my interactions that I specifically have with them in a personal setting. It's a great dude. Okay, the next one, I have another morality question. This one involves you and your baby. You have a child in this question, all right? The biggest nightmare that there ever was or will be. You, your baby, and your entire townspeople, so you have your greater family, right? Your clan, are being chased by a band of bad men. They will kill you if they find you. You don't have any weapons. You don't have any way to defend yourself, even though you are Cobra Tate. Okay. All of you decide to hide in a secret place and are silently waiting for the bad guys to move away. However, you know that your baby will cough and the band will hear him, or the baby will shit or cry, whatever the fuck babies do. They will find you, your baby, and the townspeople and kill all of you. You have two choices. Kill your baby and save yourself and the entire town, or let your baby cough and risk, you know, some kind of, just like an alien with a laser, let's say. So we wouldn't be able to do anything against it. Maybe, I mean, I wouldn't, but I'm a sissy male.
I'm never that guy who gives myself 0% chance.
Okay.
So once again, it's difficult for me to answer these questions because I know for the sake of the question, I need to believe I stand 0% chance. But I live my whole life.
Yeah.
These scenarios you're describing, I live ready for them.
Okay.
Like here, okay, bro, it's 11 p.m. for me.
Right.
I just finished dinner. I just drove home in my Bugatti. It's copper in case anyone was wondering what color it was. I'm doing a Twitch stream. My house has armed security. I have about 6 armed men outside. I'm on a Twitch stream by myself.
Right. Strap.
Like, I stay ready. Like, I'm never going to be that guy who ain't ready. You understand? So, it's difficult. But I'll try and imagine it to answer the question. So, imagine somehow I'm not ready for a conflict, which is impossible.
Yeah.
Right.
And somehow I don't stand a chance, which is impossible.
Yeah.
Because I'm not that guy.
You're not that guy.
I believe I would find a way to beat them. Have you ever seen the A-Team?
Yes, of course.
So, you know, they get, like, a rake, half a piece of sheet metal, some leaves, and they build a tank.
Yeah, right.
You know, that'd like, we're high. Okay. He's going to cough, but, like, I've got a whole 15 minutes, and, I'm a tank. But if I couldn't pull that off, then there's 0% chance I would kill my own baby. No, because I believe that I have a masculine imperative, and the masculine imperative is the bottom line. The bottom line has to be the protection of my progeny. It doesn't matter if the whole town dies. It doesn't matter if we all die. It doesn't matter if the baby dies anyway. I cannot make that call.
Okay.
When it's on the line and I have to make a call,
I have to make a call which is true to my morals, my morality, my duties, my masculine imperative, the will of God. And the will of God is for me to stand and to fight then and there. So I would prepare.
And those 15 minutes before the cough for mortal combat.
Right.
I would link my hands and prepare my mind.
Okay.
That's what I would do.
Now, I'm not fucking done.
The unexpected ending to this whole thing is that when I prepare for Mortal Kombat, everyone's going, but the alien's going to wipe you out. No, that's the part you don't get. They won't.
Yeah.
I would win.
Okay.
That's what would happen.
Alternate bit to the same question. It's your girlfriend, not a baby. And you know, she's going to whine or something like that. What would you say then?
I mean, they're a lot more disposable, aren't they?
I figured you might have a different answer.
No, but I mean, they are. Like, girlfriends can be, your baby can't be replaced. A girlfriend can be replaced. But it depends how much you love her. It depends if she's going to cough or something she can't help.
Yeah.
Fine. But if she's going to just, like, complain or something stupid.
Right.
Then perhaps it would cross my mind.
Okay.
Like, if she's not going to obey. Because that's a completely different paradigm, right? So an individual, whether a baby or a girlfriend, no matter what it is, enacting a basic human function in which they're going to produce noise, which is going to result in the annihilation of the entire clan, but it cannot be prevented, is a different scenario than a female who's complaining because I don't have a blanket and it's cold in this cave. Hiding.
Right.
Like, in such a high stress, tense situation, if she started running her mouth, I'd probably join the aliens and say, give me the laser gun.
You'd join the aliens. All right. I see what you're saying. Yeah.
Because she's just ungrateful now.
Okay.
You know, so There's nuance. It depends on the scene.
Satisfying answer. Okay, another one. This one's called the prisoner dilemma. You are a member of a gang, so there's camaraderie between you and your gang, your brothers in arms. Okay.
Correct.
You have been arrested with another member of your gang. Both of you are confined away from one another and have no way of communicating with the other member. The police do not have enough evidence to convict both of you with major charges, and instead they offer you and the other member a bargain.
Wait, are you just reading my life story or what?
Yeah, this one felt sort of personalized specifically to you. So we're gonna learn a lot from this. And I think I know the answer.
Here and done that. Carry on.
Okay. You have two choices. You will remain silent or betray the other member and testify that he has committed the crime.
What do you think?
And walk free. I would assume you would remain silent.
Do you know why?
Because you have a masculine prerogative to, you know, uphold your brothers. I assume. I figured you would start talking.
Because my brother would remain silent.
Okay. So you have to both remain silent.
I have absolute certainty that he would never betray me. This is the thing about when you actually are a man of substance and roll with men of substance.
Okay.
It's different. I know these questions, like for the person who wrote that question, is probably sitting there and he thinks this is a difficult question because I'd rat on my friends because I'm a loser and my friends are fucking losers and they'd all fuck my girl behind my back if they could. All steal money from me if they could, and I'm a loser and I go through life as a loser. They don't understand genuine.
Yeah.
Me and my boys and me and my team, I've never had a penny go missing. I have people I've shared bank accounts with for 10 years with $50, $60, $70 million. Never been stolen a penny.
Okay.
No one's ever tried a chick. No one's talked to an ex. Like, we went to war together. Me and my team, because I'm a man of substance, birds of a feather flock together. I just talked about this on another stream. Everyone around me is a man of substance. So when I sit there and I'm silent and they say, if you don't talk, your boy's going to talk, I get to look them back directly in the eyes knowing that my boy won't talk.
Okay.
So the answer is I won't talk because I know my team won't talk. So why would I talk?
Right, you understand? Right. Yeah.
Anybody who is in a gang of mine, anybody who is associated with me, lives by an honorable code. And these individuals would not turn. And for that reason, I would not turn. So both of us would remain absolutely not really silent. I don't want to sit here and give too many details away because this is the internet. But that is actually remarkably similar to a few scenarios in my life. And here I am. A free
right.
man.
True, yes, free man. It's surrounded by birds of a feather, and you guys are all flocking together, I'm assuming, right? You have a bunch of people in your compound?
I have a team as well. My team's much smaller.
I have a team, yes.
Okay, cool. I have a team as well, but my team's much smaller, and we all always wear shirts really a lot. Like, we wear, like, a lot. Are you the only one who's not wearing a shirt right now?
Do you know why I don't wear a shirt?
I don't know why.
I'll tell you why. One, it's not just because I'm built like Hercules. It's not actually why.
Right.
It's because this podcast studio used to be a bedroom, but the air conditioning is loud. So it ruins the podcast.
Okay, yeah. Okay, so here's another hot take, right? And this one I also kind of agree with, right? Because I think there's a lot of problems with people's digestive health and overall nutritional health. So is gluten intolerance real?
If someone is uncomfortable by gluten or it gives them fucking flatulence or something and they don't want to eat it, fine. I understand that, right? But to sit there and pretend that gluten's going to kill you is obviously a fallacy. If you're starving to death, there's the choice of eating gluten or eating nothing. I think that you'll live longer if you eat the bread than if you eat nothing.
Yeah, I would agree with that.
You know, so it's just a sliding scale, right? If you're uncomfortable with gluten, fine. But when I've been around people like, I can't eat gluten. You don't understand.
Yeah.
Like, no, you don't understand, G. You could eat that shit. There's nothing else to eat. Shut the fuck up. No one really cared. This is a desperate bid for individuality. That's what you're trying to do. Because you're a loser and no one around the table gives a shit about you, you think that talking about how you can't eat bread for the next 20 minutes is going to make us your friend.
If bread makes you sick, what the fuck's pussy going to do that guy?
Wait, you made a very valid point here because we're talking earlier about like my crew and who I roll with, etc. Every single man I'm caught on the street with, and I don't say this with hyperbole. This is not a joke. This is not me playing a character. This is absolutely and utterly true. Everyone I'm on the street with, we have a pact, and the pact is we all die or nobody dies.
Okay.
So if ever we do a violent confrontation, everyone's pulling the strap, bullets are going off, that's it. We're all ready to go to jail. We're all ready to die. Do you think I'm going to roll with someone who's afraid of bread?
Probably not. That's a really good point.
So anyone who's got a gluten intolerance won't talk to you. I don't know. This is some new ammo for the liberals because they already called me misogynistic, sexist. I don't know what they're going to call me now. Glutenist.
Yeah.
If you can't eat gluten, you're not on my team. I don't like weakness around me. Even people, bro, I've stopped talking to people because they were tired a lot. I've stopped talking to people. They always want a nap. I'm like, bro, why are you always napping? I don't know. I'm just tired. Well, then you're just a low energy, lethargic idiot. I just don't want to talk to you. Well, it's just a nap. No, it's not just a nap. All of us other men are up now and we have things to do. And even if we are tired, we're not going to mention it. We're just going to continue to function. High performance. That's what we're going to do until it's bedtime. You're sitting here talking about a nap like a fucking baby. No. Yeah. So nappers, I don't like people who nap. Don't like none of this shit. I don't. None of these people are around me. Because you ain't gonna be able to pull the strap if you're napping. You can't pull the strap if you're having a heart attack.
If you're sleepy. Right. Yeah, if you're sleepy, fucking toughen up a little bit.
Toughen up!
Yeah, drink some coffee.
Exactly, correct.
Okay, another question. Did you actually beat your wife? I don't even know if you have a wife. That's just a question that I have written down that people asked for me to ask you.
Interesting. And then once again, in Emergency Meeting Episode 11.
Oh, shit.
All explained.
Andrew's answer to this question was basically to redirect me and you guys to his Emergency Meeting podcast, so he can explain the quote-unquote evidence and things like that to put these allegations to rest. So feel free to check that out if you want, but I shortened the answer down so we can move on.
Bro, I'm a nice guy. It's very difficult for me to put into words how much I don't give a f-. You can call me these things. I don't care.
What if I called you Andrew Late?
That would be good because I won't.
Okay, so another negative one, right? And I have to bring this up because it's like the thing that everyone has told me whenever I said that I had an interview with Andrew Tate. They said, did you know that he is a sex trafficker? What is the explanation of that? I didn't do any research on you, by the way. He did the same thing here. That episode 11 of the Among Us podcast must be full of great information.
The girl who made up the story because her boyfriend caught her at the house and she was so stupid. I'll give you a very, very quick version. A girl called our house at a party. Her boyfriend noticed it was our house on Instagram because she did an Instagram story and he obviously follows us, our content. He said, "You're at the Tate's house." She responds saying, "Ah, yeah, but I don't want to be here."
Okay.
Some female excuse. Her boyfriend, the beta male, blows up her phone, has a mental breakdown, calls the police saying, "My girlfriend's being held hostage."
Okay, so just real quick. Your podcast is called Emergency Meeting?
Correct.
Have you ever played Among Us? Do you know what that is?
I know what it is, but I've never played it.
Okay, the main sequence in that game is you're trying to find the imposter. And in order to do that, you call an emergency meeting. So I just thought that was kind of funny that it's a huge meme that is like almost as famous as you. But you obviously don't give a fuck about Among Us, so.
No, but yeah. The reason we call it emergency meeting is because in our house, on our phones, we have an alarm we can sound from the phones that set off in the entire compound, a huge alarm. And when the alarm goes off, we have to go into we have a room, a cigar lounge, which is a cigar.
That's pretty cool, yeah. Okay, so this is kind of based on the same one. This is one that I've seen a lot of people who make videos on you, commentary channels who make videos on you on YouTube, have asked why you got kicked off of Big Brother in 2016. Not necessarily through eyes, but read the articles.
I'll tell you why I was kicked off. Okay. So that whole woman bullshit was an excuse why the producers kicked me out. Here's what really happened. I was in Big Brother. There's two separate houses. I was in the separate house at the beginning. I walked into the main house after about a week, and I sat everyone down and told them they're all snakes. This is all available on YouTube. Everyone had a mental breakdown, right? Because I told them that I'd been watching them on a monitor from the other house and they're all bitching about each other and none of them are actually friends and they're all snakes.
Yeah.
That was about 50% true, but I exaggerated because I wanted to cause division and upset the whole house.
Right. Mind games.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, I'm walking into a situation now, right? This is how my mind works. I'm walking into a situation now where there are 15 people who have been removed from their families and their support structures, who have now all attached onto each other and established bonds and friendships. I'm walking in as an outsider. I want to have control of this social circle and this social scenario because every single thing is going to be watched on television. So what I have to do is I break all social bonds and all social paradigms so they can be built up from the ground up in a way which favors me. They've been built up without my influence and without my power. So I need to destroy them all. So I thought by going in there and telling them all that they're all a bunch of snakes and none of their friends are actually their friends, it's going to cause mass mental breakdown, and amongst the chaos I can take control because I am a genius. If I was a little dork, it wouldn't work. Right. But they took me very, very seriously. So when I said it, a couple of the men tried to get aggressive, but of course they wouldn't touch me because I am me. So a couple of girls had mental breakdowns because they're idiots, because then they start going, "Were you talking shit about me? Were you talking shit about me?" Because they instantly, their friendships fell apart. A couple of girls escaped from the house. One of them started getting, because these people who go on reality TV are the very, very lowest IQ.
Yeah, the lowest common denominator. They have to appeal to the masses. I get what you're saying.
Yeah, they're idiots. So a bunch of girls started escaping from the house, whatever, whatever. One guy who was in love with this girl, she ran away and said I was reptilian and cold. I remember that line, reptilian and cold. So now he's upset because the girl he fancied's left. So all the dudes start getting aggressive to me. So I got into a scenario where there's these five guys getting aggressive towards me. I'm standing there. This is all on camera, standing there saying, "Look, I can say whatever the fuck I want. You want to do something, do something." The rules of the Big Brother house are you are not allowed to attack people or touch people physically. Of course, those are the rules of the house.
Yeah.
So when they took me into the diary room, they said, "Look, Andrew, the rules of the house are they're not supposed to touch you, but the situation's getting very, very heated and you've upset people a lot. And we need a guarantee, because obviously you're a professional fighter, we need a guarantee that in the event of a physical altercation, you will wait for security to come in and break it up." And I said, no. The rules of the house is that people don't start fights. I've come in here and said words, which I'm allowed to do. If any of these people touch me, I will destroy them absolutely and completely. I'm not going to play Floyd Mayweather and dodge punches waiting for your security. If any of these men touch me, I will annihilate them, yeah. All of them.
Okay.
That is my imperative. That's my imperative to self-defense. If these idiots can't control themselves and they're upset that I came in and made their stupid little girlfriends run away, that is their issue. It's not my issue. And the producers got very, very uncomfortable because now they're in a scenario where they know a professionally trained fighter against a bunch of emotional children, it's about to kick off. But there's five of them and one of me. And they understood that the chance of there being a physical altercation on a long enough time frame was now 100%. And they had to decide, do we remove five people from the house or one person from the house?
It's a moral dilemma.
It's a moral dilemma. They flicked the lever and I had to go. I was too good upsetting the social paradigm. I was too good at what they wanted me to do.
Yeah, no, I understand. Cool, that's a good answer. So I have another one. You are a felon, correct?
Incorrect. A felon would be convicted of a crime, correct? And serve jail time, correct?
Yes, I believe so. That's the technical...
But what if I was innocent? What if I served jail time if I was innocent? What if in a hypothetical scenario, what if I've served jail time because I didn't talk, because I knew my boy wouldn't talk, and I was just doing what a guy should do for his friend? Am I a felon by not ratting on my boy?
I think in the eyes of the law, yes, but in your own belief and heart, no. And technically, if everything was fully translucent, you could see every in and out, then no, you would not be a felon.
Yeah, so it also depends. Like, I will not accept the label felon, because accepting the label felon is accepting that the Matrix labeling me. And the Matrix labels lots of people lots of different ways, right? They've labeled you with a condition. I'm sure a psychiatrist would label me with something and I'd completely ignore it. Yeah. They label people as racist who aren't racist. They label people as sexist who aren't sexist. They label people things. And I don't believe in Matrix labels. So when you say felon, I'm thinking of somebody who goes out there with the intention of doing harm to other people, like robbing old ladies and breaking into houses, etc. That's not who I am. I'm a man of honor. I'm a man of courage. I'm a man of duty. I live by a very strong masculine imperative, which I'd never hurt a woman and never hurt a child. I'm not a bad person. So I refuse to accept the label of felon.
Okay. That's a great answer. Cool. Why are you bald?
I shaved all my hair off, and I'll tell you why. Because people make fun of me for being bald. Hey, you're bald. As in, like, I haven't noticed something.
Right.
Well, yeah, correct.
Yeah.
I shave my head 3 times a week. Like, so I could grow hair back as beautiful as yours.
Thank you.
I'm not missing my hair at all. My hairline's fine. I could grow my full, I could have full head of hair like Tristan if I decided to. When I was maybe 10, my mother and father, we grew up in Indiana in America, and my mother and father got a divorce, and my dad stayed in America, and my mother moved back to England with me, my brother, and my sister.
Right.
When they got the divorce, because my mom was originally from England, and England has a social care system where you get a free house and you can live from the government money, whatever. So we had to move back to England. Yeah. So we moved back to England to a really bad area because it's free housing. And my father stayed in America to play chess because there's no chess scene where you can live off of in Europe at the time. I didn't see my father very often, but my father was a massive influence in my life. I think I had the best father on the planet. I think he was the smartest man who's ever walked the earth, bar none. Smarter than me by 100 times. I wish he was alive because having him on a podcast would break the internet. Dude was a genius. I have so many stories to prove his genius, but that's a tangent.
I have a little tangent here too. Your dad is Emery Tate, right?
Correct.
So in 2010, what year did he pass away?
It was about 7 or 8 years ago now. It might have been then. Yeah.
So in 2010, I went to a benefit with a very rich family friend of mine, and there was a man who played chess that went by the name of Mr. Tate there. And he was an older African-American fellow. And I'm not sure if that was your father, if I met your father.
Yep, you met my dad.
Which is really strange. Also, Lady Gaga's ex-boyfriend was there, too. That was like another kind of claim to fame that was at that event. But yeah, I just thought that was really interesting. I thought I should bring that up because I believe that I have met your father when I was a child.
That's amazing to hear. That's truly amazing to hear because the Matrix in strange ways, and that's amazing to hear. And yes, Mr. Tate, the older African-American chess player, was my father, correct?
Yes, I played chess with him. He destroyed me. I was 9 years old.
I only saw my father maybe once a year at this point. I was about 10 years old. We'd moved from America 2 years before. I'm now living with my mother. By coincidence, my father was coming to visit, so my mom said, you have to get a haircut. Your father's coming. You need to look good. It's like, cool. So we went to the hairdressers. The hairdresser was full, our normal hairdresser, so we went to another hairdresser. I got a haircut at the other hairdresser. My mom said, I don't like how they've cut your hair. I don't like how they've cut your hair. It doesn't look as good. Whatever. I'm 10, so I'm just a kid, right?
Yeah, you don't care.
My dad turns up. First time I've seen my dad in a year. He gets in the house. He's in the house for about 5 minutes. And my mom's like, yeah, I took him for a haircut, Emery, but Emery was his name. Emery. But I didn't like the way they cut their hair. And my dad's like, well, and then I'm like, yeah, I don't like how they've cut it. And my dad went nuts. My dad went, you're raising my boys, talking about how their hair looks. They're 10 years old. You got them looking in the mirror like girls, talk about their hair. What's wrong with you, woman? You're gonna my boys up. And he lost his temper big, right?
Mm-hmm.
My mom was all scared and said, oh, Emery, it's the first time I've seen you in a year. This is why we couldn't be together anymore. You're crazy. Called the police and told my dad to leave the house because my dad's saying, look, you can't raise my boys. You're going to raise them bitches. That I lost his temper. My dad was a big guy, scary guy, right? Police came, kicked my dad out. So the first time I see my dad in a year, he gets kicked out of the house in less than an hour. He messages my mom and says, look, I want to see my boys. I don't want to come to the house. I don't want to see you, bitch. I want to see my sons. So my mom puts us in a taxi to go over to his hotel. We go to his hotel, and he takes me, and he marches me down to the hairdresser, and he says, son, I'm going to shave all your hair off. And I'm only 10. Mm-hmm. So I'm like, why? Why? He's like, when you grow up and you become a man, you'll realize that nobody gives a shit about the kind of hair you have. They care about the kind of man you are. They care about your qualities as a man. Haircut is probably the least important thing. Only low quality men are going to judge themselves on a fucking haircut. If you have any kind of substance, any kind of capability as a man, it doesn't matter what your hair looks like. We're going to shave your head. So he sat me down in this chair. They start shaving my head. And because I'm only 10, I started crying, right? I don't know if the kids at school might make fun of me, whatever. I don't know. I'm 10, right? Mm-hmm. I'm human. I'm a child. I start crying. Shave my head. He sent me back to my mom. My mom went nuts. I remember her on the phone. Oh, you're never going to see them again, Emery. Because she's only, my mom's a good person, but she's a female. She doesn't understand the real world. Women don't understand the real world.
Is she still around?
She's still around.
Okay. Yeah.
You're never going to see them again, Emery. You're fucking, he's crying. Why did you do this? You traumatized him. Da, 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 all this shit. So this was the story of how it happened. And my dad, after only being in England for 2 days, once he realized after he shaved my head, he left. And he sent me a message he emailed me at the time. And he said, look, when you grow up, you're going to understand that I'm not going to have my sons raised in a paradigm where they're concerned about their haircut. That is detrimental for your mindset as a man. Life is difficult as a man, and you've got bigger worries. Your mother doesn't listen to me anymore. She won't understand. Everyone's calling me crazy now, and she called the police on me, and I'm a crazy guy. I don't mind being crazy, son. I'll be as crazy as the world calls me, son. I'm 6'3", kickboxing world champion, multimillionaire, top G. I'm here on the internet saying all these things. I'm teaching me. Who gives a about my hair? Anyone who's going to be concerned about my haircut is missing the broader message I'm trying to broadcast to the world. Like, if you're listening to my words, talking about strength and heroism and all these things that can genuinely change your life, and you're sitting there going, yeah, but your haircut, like, then you're just a dumbass. So that doesn't bother me. So it's a two-tiered story. It's my father's first original story, and then the time it truly hit me and I realized how correct he was.
Right.
Now, when I have sons, because I will die with 20 sons by 20 beauty queens. I've already made that proclamation.
Do you have any sons
when
yet?
I'm not prepared to disclose how many children I have if I have children.
Okay, go ahead.
When I have 20 sons by 20 women, because I have nothing else to do and I'm rich. When I have 20 sons by 20 women, they're going to go through the exact same traumatic. It's not even trauma, but trauma. Yeah. They're going to go through the same process. There's going to be a day I'm going to walk them in there and shave their heads and say, no, you are a man. I'm going to tell them the exact same shit my father said to me, because that's because my dad was so right. Mm-hmm. It's really amazing. I wish my father was alive, because all the times everyone called him crazy, people called him crazy his whole life. And as I've lived my life, I just have 100 examples of him being completely correct every time. He was right. The world, when the world calls people crazy, listen, everyone's calling me crazy now, right? Mm-hmm. Tate's crazy. But the people with a brain are listening to me going, Tate's not crazy. Tate's fucking right. Tate's correct. So that's why I have no hair, and that's why I refuse to have a haircut anymore of any kind, because I can't sit there as a full-grown man in a chair with another full-grown man and start explaining how I need my hair cut so I don't feel insecure. If you don't cut it this way, I'm gonna be shy. It's stupid. Shave it off. I don't. Who gives a f***?
Out of just curiosity, would you, like, if there was something you could say to, like, young people, I'm talking like children, like 12 to 14, right? Not like people who have fully formed frontal lobes like myself. I want there to be something positive that can be taken from this, from even people who hate you, right? What would be that advice that you would have for a young person who's not competent, who has maybe no role model, parents suck, failed by public school. I was homeschooled, by the way. If you understand what I'm trying to say here, I'm rambling a little bit.
No, I understand. It's difficult to answer to everyone, because the answer to the haters and answering to the young men is different. To the young men, I would say that you are, like I said earlier, you are born in a fortunate but unfortunate situation in which you are a blank canvas as a man. You have no innate value. You are the lowest possible. Male life has no significance. Nobody cares, right? If you talk about 10 women dying in a car crash, everyone cares. You talk about 10 men dying at war, nobody cares. Nobody cares about men dying.
Yeah.
Nobody cares. So male life has no innate value, unlike female life, which is innately important because women can reproduce. You have no innate value, which is a negative, right? But you have to turn all negatives into positives. Because you have no innate value, you get the possibility to build yourself from the ground up. Just like when you start a video game, your character isn't worth shit. Mm-hmm. But if you go out there, you do difficult things, you make money, you complete quests, you get better weapons, you get more money, whatever it takes, you get to level up and you get to become a hero. That is what life is like as a man for real. It's going to suck. Sometimes you're going to suffer. You're going to go through pain. But all that pain you go through is absolutely and utterly necessary for you to become the man you want to be. So what I would say to the young men out there is that life is going to be hard. but you need to stop trying to shy away from hardness. Don't feel sorry for yourself. Every single time something happens that's hard to you, you need to sit there and go, good, how can I use this to become a better person? Because a man, becoming a man and staying a man is a very long process, and it's a very, very long journey. That's what I say to the young men. To all the haters out there, I'd say something else. I would say that even if my points of view are extremely and utterly offensive to you and you don't agree with anything I say, that's fine. But to find balance in and of the universe, you have to have opposing viewpoints. The way you have centrists is you have right-wing people and left-wing people, and then you have the people in the middle. Even if you completely disagree with everything and everything I say, that's fine. I am, basically everything I say is going against the modern narratives of the world, and you need balance in the universe.
Yeah.
If you have half a brain, even if you disagree with everything I say, you'll sit there and go, well, I disagree with this guy, but I have a brain, and I understand that the universe needs balance, and he's arguing the counter viewpoint to viewpoints which are heavily propagated by the Matrix and purported by systems. And you know what? It's about time someone stood up and said the opposite side of things. Even if you disagree with it, it is right. A benefit for the universe to have balance. Yin and yang.
Okay.
It's all this time itself. So anyone with a brain does not need to be offended by me. The young men out there understand that life's going to be hard, but they need to listen to me. And that I've got my programs. I've got Hustlers University. I've got War Room. You can go to CorporateTake.com. I'm happy to teach anyone who's willing to listen.
Yeah.
And the last thing I'm going to do is tell them to walk around and say they're a G before they're a G. That's the last thing I'm going to do.
Yeah, I just don't want... Yeah, that's what I just don't want people... Because I feel like I'm, successful for my age, especially. I've done a lot for, relatively speaking, to my peers. Not trying to brag, obviously, but I'm also bragging a little bit. And I'm, sometimes I feel pretty arrogant, I'll be honest.
Come on.
But So it's just a natural feeling. I do have a great innate respect for women as well. Like, my mom is a very strong person who runs part of my business. And she does so in a way that I wouldn't have anyone else run. She's very ambitious, very smart, extremely smart. She's great at mind games, chess. She's super manipulative in a good way, right?
Oh, and listen, I have an innate respect for women. This is what people don't understand. But I am just very, very aware of where their competence lies and where it doesn't. I say this in all of my podcasts. I say this all the time. I say women can't drive and people say you hate women. I say, no, I don't. I think that men drive better than women. However, if I would never drop my child at an all-male nursery, if I needed a nurse or I was sick,
right,
I would want...
Yeah.
So women are... All I'm saying is that women are better at different things than men, and men are better at different things than women. This is largely accepted in 95% of the world today. It was largely accepted in 100% of the world only 50 years ago.
Right.
It's not controversial on any level. All I'm saying is that men and women are different, and we're better at different things. I have an innate respect for women the same. There are certain things inside of my empire, very much like yours, that I will only task to females because they are better at it than men. And there are certain things I will only task to men because they are better at it than females. I have innate respect for both sexes, but as a professional, I have to understand when and where to place them. You put your soldiers, your men on the front line, and you put the nurses, the women in the medical tent. That's just called being fucking smart.
Yeah.
That's not a disrespect for females or males. And anyone who's going to come here and say, well, he hates women because he says that, that, that. I'm saying that women are better at some things and men are better at other things.
Yeah.
You do not have the IQ to understand that, and you listen to me say that, and you can only deduce that I hate women, then you are a jackass.
Yeah, I think the big thing would be kids watching you walking around saying I'm a top G and bitches can't drive, they ain't shit. You know what I mean? Like a 12-year-old.
I understand, but I also think the internet is full of influences, and I think if you were to even take my influence away, I think there's maybe 100,000 influences on the internet which are negative for 12-year-olds. I don't think 12-year-olds should be on the internet. Tell me a single name an influence on the internet that's good for 12-year-olds. I guess your number one income stream is Twitch or
YouTube,
broadcast.
Yeah. YouTube, yeah.
12-year-olds are watching you sitting here saying he is making more money than a doctor making YouTube videos. I don't want to go to school. I don't want to become a doctor. I want to study
hard.
I want to make videos. That's all I want to do. I want to make YouTube videos. I think they did a study, and it was actually very interesting to see. They said in China, they asked most people under the age of 15 what they wanted to be, and the number one answer was astronaut or engineer.
Yes,
and
the Western world.
Yeah, the Western world,
everyone's
a YouTuber. So even if you sit here and say nothing but good things, you are a negative influence to a 12-year-old.
That is true.
Watch any YouTube video through the eyes of a 12-year-old and tell me it's a net positive. It's all garbage. It's all garbage. So this ain't a me problem. This is an internet problem.
Yeah, I do think, though, if you're talking about, like, in terms of choosing a career, probably there's no positive influences, but definitely, like, health and fitness stuff. is a net positive for sure for young people.
Which I support.
Yeah. Just as an example, I was going to say that would definitely be an overall positive, because being healthy is really important, and people don't learn how to do that
in
their lives.
So my point is that I understand your point you're making. A 12-year-old running a top G did it. I completely get that. I respect it. I don't want to see a 12-year-old do that shit. If my 12-year-old son did that, I'd slap him in the mouth because he's a dumbass. But I would, right? But right. My point is, also, if a 12-year-old watches you, he wants to be a YouTuber, he doesn't want to try in school anymore.
No, you're right. That's correct.
It's that's just the internet as a whole.
Yeah.
So for them to come along and try and say that I'm the problem, when really it's the whole internet's the problem, is garbage. I think you would struggle to find a video on YouTube that would not be negative through the eyes of a 12-year-old. Any of it. Most of it's garbage, yeah. G. Most of it's garbage. Most of it's just playing video games. Most of it's just dumb
shit.
Right, yep. It's all garbage. I like to think that at least in my message, okay, yeah, it can be misunderstood, but there's still a lot of positive influence for any man with half a brain.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah, right.
The whole internet's trash. Society is trash. The Matrix is trash. It's all trash. I'm trying to break people free of it. I'm trying to make people resist the slave mind. The people who listen to me, at least they only watch my shit. They don't watch anything else. And they're like, you know what? The whole internet's crap. Andrew said do push-ups. I'm gonna do some push-ups. I completely respect the point you're making, but
yeah,
that's not a me problem. That's an internet problem.
Yeah, and I do agree. I do completely agree. It's if people were raised in a way and were educated in a way to be able to pull specific things to understand nuance, there would be way less problems in the world. All comes down to education. A lot of things that in a vacuum are amazing pieces of advice, especially for young men. Okay. Like I genuinely believe that. But I think that a lot of the people that are seeing what you're saying, especially the young men who are a victim of TikTok, who are a victim of public schooling, who are a victim of having not poor as in monetarily poor, financially poor, but as in mentally poor, distracted parents who don't pay attention to their kids. They see you, they see the things that you're doing, they see how flashy you are, they see the sense of humor, they see the shit you have.
They'll take it out of context and use it negatively.
Yeah, they take it out of context. They take those things and then they just mistreat, they do what people are afraid that you're causing. They do that, right? Because they're stupid. Because there's a lot of people who are just stupid who take advice and they use it incorrectly. Like I could read, I look at history a lot. I look at history and I learn from evil things. You can extract things and you can make them a part of yourself. A lot of people cannot do that. And I do feel that a lot of young people probably will be not necessarily douchebags, but they're going to become incels, I feel like. Because
I agree.
You think so? You agree? Okay. Yeah. Okay, I got some dumb shit to ask you now, all right? Do you watch the Special Olympics?
No. I also don't watch the normal Olympics.
Okay, there you go. Yeah, that's fine then.
No. But for the sake of the trap, I'm interested in let's going further with this. Let's assume I watch the normal Olympics and I don't watch the Special Olympics. Let's continue. Let's say I don't watch the Special Olympics. No, I don't.
Oh, neither do I. Okay, so that's all.
Why do you ask?
I just was wondering. I was just curious.
I don't think the Special Olympics is particularly interesting because I don't think it's fair.
You think it's unequal? There's an inequity, a basic inequity in the Special Olympics that makes you not interested in watching it, televising. I feel like it probably shouldn't be televised.
Yeah, there's probably a basic inequity and in every single competition, right? I don't know, and I might be wrong, but like someone has one leg missing, he's still racing against someone with two legs missing, correct? They don't have like a one leg race, a two leg race.
Yeah, there'd be too many categories.
If he lost his leg up to the knee, he lost his ankle, whatever. So there's innate indifferences in every single competitor. So someone has an innate advantage. So it just doesn't feel competitive. So it doesn't feel interesting to me.
Okay, that's totally fair. Have you ever partied with Hunter Biden?
No, I've never partied with Hunter Biden. He ain't my kind of party. I don't like drugs. I've never taken a drug in my entire life. Okay. I've never tried weed. I've never tried cocaine. I've never even tried them. Not even once.
I agree. I'm a teetotaler.
So that's one thing. And also Hunter Biden buys hookers and I don't pay for sex. I've never paid for sex once in my entire life. I can't think of anything more embarrassing.
Yeah, that guy documents every second of his hooker and drug binges too, doesn't he? It's crazy. I was going to ask you a question about your browsing history on Google. What's like crazy shit you search? Would you be comfortable with sharing it? Not saying you have to, but what is your, do you have fucked up browsing history? What's some crazy shit?
I'm looking now. I just clicked on it. Oh, this is all just emergency meeting, YouTube, play chess online, get my ass beaten. I'm not that good. Mine's pretty clean, bro. I think I'd be very happy for someone to go through this and like bust me. There's nothing. Chess, Instagram, YouTube. I don't like porn.
think porn's interesting. It's never been interesting to me. Even when I was younger, even before I had unlimited sexual access, I was not interested in porn.
I don't watch porn either. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm trying to think of the craziest thing I'll look for on the internet. I do. I used to watch all those gore videos.
Best gore? Yeah. Yeah. Me too. I like to look at that stuff, and like every time there's anything that happens terrible, I try to find all the footage of it so I like can get those images in my mind. So I'm like prepared, I guess, for like the world being a terrifying place, because it seems like it's just becoming more and more normal.
You nailed it, bro. You nailed it. That's exactly why I did it. I desensitized myself. So now if something bad, like if the person next to me takes a bullet in the head, I'm not going to panic. I'm just going to pull the strap and get the job done.
I would probably still panic.
I've like seen that before.
Oh yeah. Okay. Do you ever watch High? That's porn. So no.
No, I don't. But I have a few chicks who fucking adore it, who love it.
Okay. Do you have any figurines or anything like that? Like
nothing like that. But a couple times I've like gone into the bedroom and I've caught my chick naked watching this cartoon sex shit. I'm like, well, you're crazy.
Okay. How often do you off?
I can state here publicly on the internet that I have not matched once in maybe 10 years.
Damn.
Never. And I'll tell you why. I have unlimited sexual access, which makes it extremely, right? I have unlimited sexual access. But even for the period, let's say there's like 3 days, I was driving a car, I was by myself, and I didn't have a chick with me.
Mm-hmm.
It's very rare. I always have women around me. I literally, truly have unlimited sexual access. I can go to any new city on the planet. You could drop me in Louisville, Kentucky, and I would have to do is go on Instagram, type in Louisville, Kentucky at the top, DM 10 10 girls. That's DM 10, yeah, yeah. 8 replies, 5 dates, same day. Boom. Like I have unlimited sexual access. I never, ever, ever fail. I can have anything I want all the time. So that's one reason, no. And two, I don't think I'd literally be able to pull it off, because God's always watching and God loves me. And
okay.
Me and God are close.
That's an interesting answer. Which Mario Kart character would you be most likely to have sex with?
When I played Mario Kart, I was always the mushroom. But I don't really want to fuck the mushroom. So I have to say Princess Peach. I mean, I can't say Bowser now, can I?
No.
It's got to be Princess Peach. I mean, she's blonde. She's a hottie. But you know what?
Yeah.
I've always been a bit suspicious of that bitch, because she's always like getting kidnapped.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Don't you think, like, if you're a Mario, you go through all that shit, you dodge the fireballs, you jump all those fucking levels,
she's finally a damsel in distress.
Yeah, you get her out, you save her from Bowser, and then like 10 minutes later, you catch her at his house again. You're back at he kidnapped me. Like, this sounds a lot like my human trafficker story bullshit. Like, you ain't been kidnapped. You keep going to Bowser on the sly and getting caught. So I think she's cheating anyway. I'll be honest with you. I think she's a hoe.
What do you think about lesbians?
I have no problem with lesbians, but I do have something I don't understand. I don't understand why a woman would decide she doesn't like men to get with a woman who looks and acts like a man.
Okay, yeah, that's sort of what I was wondering. Like, women who adopt masculine behavioral features, patterns, like that's basically what I was asking. You don't understand that doesn't make any sense to you.
I don't understand the sexual aspect of it. I'm saying if you're a lesbian and you like hot, attractive women, Barbie dolls like I do, I get that. But if you say I'm a lesbian and then you end up with a woman who looks and acts and talks like a man, as masculine as possible, why don't you want to be with a man? That doesn't make sense to me. I don't understand the paradigm. If you're a lesbian and you're with hot, beautiful other women, I understand that. You're attracted to women. I get it. Women are hot. I agree with you. I feel the same. But if you're a woman who says, I don't like men, so I get with a woman who's as close to a man as a woman can be, that doesn't make sense to me in my mind. I don't get that.
Are you a lesbian?
I guess I would be, yeah. I mean, I'm attracted to women.
Okay. Do you jelk?
What is that?
It's when guys take their hand like this, hold the tip of their penis, and then they like take their other hand and they just like make their dick longer. They like force blood into their wiener and make their wiener longer. It's really popular on the internet.
Ah, I get it. No, sir.
Okay.
It must be a YouTube thing. I never heard of it.
It's like a funny internet thing. It's what about pilking? Do you pilk?
What's pilking?
Pilking is when you try to get as much blood in the tip of your penis as possible so it becomes large like a strawberry and red.
No, I've yet to partake. Perhaps no. Like, it's kind of like drugs. Like, some things I've decided I've made it to this age without ever trying drugs, so there's no point starting now. I'm gonna add pilking to that.
Okay. So, what are your thoughts on femboys? This is a internet phenomena of men who identify as men that cross dress and then they make videos and content, and then people are very attracted to it. A lot of people like to joke and think that I am a femboy myself, or that I like femboys, which I do not. I'm a straight, white, cis male who likes beautiful women. What do you think about femboys?
It's a culture I'm unfamiliar with. I think that a lot of people do a lot of crazy things for attention on the internet. And I would like to try and protect my reality from certain cultures. I don't see how me understanding or knowing more about or observing femboys, I don't see how that can possibly benefit my life in any way. If I die having never truly understood the culture of femboys, I don't think that's going to be bad for me. I think that's fine. So I don't know, and I don't want to know. It's like it's a box that I don't want to open.
Okay, a Pandora's box with a dick in it.
Yeah, perhaps. I don't understand it. I don't want to learn about it. Like I only have so many conscious hours until it's the game over, and I only have so much mental space. I only have so much time in the day, and I really just don't want to understand any more about. You've told me enough.
Okay.
And that's where it ends.
That's fair. So this is an interesting one that I feel like may be another moral quandary, but not really at all, to be honest. Everyone has a number. How much money would it take for you to suck a man off to completion?
For me, there's no number because I have unlimited money.
I figured that would be your answer. What are your thoughts on Sigma males? They're like the grind set, American Psycho type characters.
I think that everything in life requires balance, and it's good to work hard, and it's good to have, certain tendencies. Sociopathic tendencies can be very beneficial in business in many ways. But if you want a life which is truly fulfilled, you need a life full of love. My life is full of love. I have a lot of people who love me and a lot of people I love back. And I think that love is a beautiful thing. So I think that is not an area in life you should neglect. And if you have a life only full of love and you don't have anything else, then once again, you're going to be unhappy. Happiness requires balance, and you need everything.
Okay, that was a really good answer, honestly. I'm crying a little bit here.